we talk about here. I hope you are happy to be here today. I hope God has been... Who has God blessed this week? Say amen.
Amen.
Has God been good to you?
Amen.
Amen. He's gotten me through a busy week. The week went by really fast. That's when you know you've had a busy week. I left my remote over here. Can we get the sermon up there, guys? If you wouldn't mind, I think Ralph's working on it. He's got the scowl of what's going on here on his face. I'm sure he'll have it here in a second. So today I'm excited for our afternoon concert. Thank you, Ralph. He's a miracle worker back there. We have our concert at 3 o'clock. We look forward to hearing more from our Maplewood Academy choir. And also, there's going to be some special guests mixed in, from what I understand, our King's Kids and maybe some others. So we hope that you'll stay by. There's food for us all to enjoy. And I hope we pack it like we normally do down there. So February 25th. Boy, you know, earlier this week they were saying, it's Snowmageddon, right? I don't think I got a flake at my house. Southern Minnesota got hit pretty hard, though, so our prayers are with them. I'm excited about our message today because it's one of my... how do I say this? One of the passages of Scripture that I'm most interested in. It's so deep, it's not very long, but it is biblical psychology, and it's Paul explaining the psychology of the world and the culture that we're living in. And it's going to connect right with our sermon last week. But number one, we're going to start with, why are we in the world? Why are we in the conditions that we're in? What are some things that we need to be aware of? But also, what are some things that we struggle with as a church when it comes to ministering and seeking out people that aren't like us? And we're going to challenge ourselves with these things. We're going to spend most of our time in Romans chapter 1, and we're going to ask some difficult questions. Some of those questions, I don't have the answers for you. It's going to take you taking this and wrestling with it on your own in prayer with God to really begin to understand what this means. But the bottom line is, and this is the takeaway phrase from the message today, born-again people have to think like born-again people. Amen? If you're a new creation, you must think like a new creation. One of the biggest cringeworthy moments for me as a pastor is when someone comes up to me and says, Pastor, what do we believe about this? Now, I understand why people ask that question, because they're looking for leadership and guidance and maybe wisdom on a topic. But the problem is what that means is people are willing to submit themselves to what an institution or a pastor thinks about an issue. What God wants for all of us is to begin to think like new creations, to take this gospel, to take this light from our Lord Jesus Christ, and begin to think for ourselves within our context. Are you following what I'm saying? What we need to begin to do is think differently based on where God has placed you. And here's the important part. If God doesn't reach your coworkers, who's going to? God doesn't reach your friends, who is going to? And this Christian life is far more complicated. It's beautiful, but it's far more complicated than just a bunch of rules and regulations. It's more complicated than just a bunch of black and white commandments, because when you go out into the world realizing that you're taking the light of the world to the world, you understand that it gets complicated when you're trying to witness to people. It gets complicated when you try to show love and how do I connect with people? It gets complicated. And so we're going to take some biblical psychology here, the psychology of worship, the psychology of our world conditions, apply them to the world, apply them to ourselves, and see how we can be a light in our context and also as a church. Amen? if we are new creations, we have to start thinking like new creations. Amen? In every area of our lives. Before we get too much further, let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Thank you, Jesus, for your love for us. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you that when we see you, we know what God looks like. When we see you, we know what love is. When we see you, we know what humanity was made to be in the beginning. When we see you, Lord, our hearts are thrilled because we see what your purpose is for our lives. And so we ask, oh God, that your Spirit would be here, that we would be a light to this world to challenge the darkened thinking of the world that we live in. Thank you, Lord. Bless us to this end, we pray. Let all of God's people say, amen. I want us to see this. Being a Christian is every bit as much what? Thinking as it is what? Living. You see, sometimes we get into a bit of a rut. We have our standards, we have our codes of conduct, the way to live, and as long as we're sort of abiding by that lifestyle, we think we're good. Now, the codes and the rules and regulations and commandments in Scripture, we talked about those last week. We understand why they exist. God created life. He knows how to put it together, and when we live within the life that He has put together, it's when we're most happy, amen? When we are outside of the life that He has put together, we can't be happy. And so, what we need to realize, though, is that these commandments that God has given to us, these ways of living, are principles that lead us to deeper understanding about life and about God. Are we all together so far? They're principles that teach us more. They're principles that teach us how to navigate life, how to understand good and evil. They're deeper spiritual principles. If you get into a rut thinking, well, as long as I am abiding by the commandments, I'm good. Do you know what? Can you think of a Bible character that thought that way? How about Saul? I was a Pharisee of Pharisees. I kept the law as best as anybody could possibly keep it. I was perfectly righteous, but then when I understand what the true meaning of the law was, I died. That's what he says. Sin revived and I died. These commandments and the way of life that the Bible projects, being a Jesus follower, is more than just behaving. It's also thinking. What does it mean to be a new creation living in a dying world? What does that mean? Scripture tells us that being part of the renewed community or kingdom of God affects how we think about the world. Do you believe that? You believe that? And if you're not thinking about that, you're probably hoping that your Christianity will wall you off to the rest of the world, that you will never be rubbing shoulders where you have deeper questions to ask. And some of us treat our Christianity that way. I treat our church that way, as if it's this fortress. The problem is if we wall ourselves inside the fortress and never rub shoulders with people that make us ask deeper questions, we aren't fulfilling our gospel mission. You following me? Genesis 3:15. I want you to go there. This is a beautiful and powerful passage that tells us just how good the good news is. So go to Genesis chapter 3. Let's set some context first. Adam and Eve have just disobeyed God. They've gone outside of the framework for life that God has set up. And as we said a couple weeks ago, when you start to live outside of God's framework for life, sadness comes, consequences come. And God is beginning to paint the picture of what these consequences are. And he's speaking to the serpent here at this point. And he says something powerful and important. He says, I will put, what word? What is that word? Enmity. Who knows what the word enmity means? Hatred. That's right. I will put hatred between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. Now, this doesn't just mean, ladies, that you'll be afraid of snakes, okay? A couple summers ago, our 7-year-old, she found a grass snake at a family member's home, and she picks it up and says, look, you know, My wife was freaking out. That's not what this is talking about. This is what Jesus is proclaiming to Satan about what God will do inside the human race. He's saying that the seed, of course, we know ultimately is Jesus, but we are all the seed of Eve, aren't we, in many ways? What God tells us, what the gospel tells us, is that deep in the heart of every man, God has placed a hatred of sin and death and the way this world works. Do you know how I know that's true? You want some proof? I guess you don't. We'll just move on. You want some proof? Why do you cry at funerals? Think about this. If there was not an enmity or a hatred of the way this world works, we would go to funerals and just be like, yeah, it happens. God has put a hatred of death in our hearts. It's not supposed to be. God has put a hatred of the way this world works into our hearts. Deep within us, we know this isn't the way life was supposed to be, and if we let this grow inside of us, we'll hate the way the world works, and we will long for the life that God has designed for us. So this tells me, my friends, that the good news, the gospel, is really good news. Because if we start out that way, and of course we have this tension between our human nature and our propensity to sin, but also a hatred of sin, there's always that tension there. But if we let this gift that God has put into humanity work, it's easier to be saved than it is to be lost. The problem is, we often don't let it work. And I'm going to show you the biblical psychology that Paul brings out of why that is. We're going to look at the psychology of our world. Go in your Bibles to Romans chapter 1, beginning in verse 20. Romans chapter 1, beginning in verse 20. When you're there, say amen. Romans 1, 20. Romans 1:20. Have you got it? You said yes, not amen. Who's there? Say amen. Amen. All right, very good. Romans 1:20. We're going to read through this passage, and this is the passage that I was referring to when we started. Romans chapter 1 and verse 20. The Bible says, "For since the creation of the world, His being God's, invisible attributes are what? Clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so that people groups that have sort of turned their back on God in the context here, but this refers to everyone, so that they are without what? Excuse. So let me ask you this. What does Paul believe about atheists? Are there any actual true atheists? There are no true atheists. He says, there is no excuse. No one will stand before God and say, I didn't know you existed. There are really two kinds of atheists, as far as I can tell. Okay? The first kind of atheist is the person that says, the God that I've been introduced to by other people isn't worth believing in. Did you follow that? Yes or no? The God that I've been introduced to by other people isn't worth believing in. So in other words, the character, the attributes, the way I've been treated, the way so-called Christians have treated me, somehow the character of God that has been painted for people isn't worth believing in. There's a lot of people out there like that. A lot of people out there like that. But here's the problem. They end up rejecting a God that doesn't even exist. There are a lot of people out there saying, God doesn't exist. And I say, yeah, that's true. The God that you think isn't there, isn't there. Is that true? Yes or no? Because if you have a false picture of God's character and you reject His existence, I agree with you. That God doesn't exist. Which is why it's so important that we let Jesus answer the questions about God for us. People say, what is God like? What are His attributes? You know what I tell them? Look at Jesus. If you want to know what God looks like, look at Jesus. That's who He is. He clears up all the questions. So that's the first kind of atheist. The second kind of atheist is the kind of atheist that says, belief in God would be inconvenient to my lifestyle. Anybody know people like that? And the issue with this is it's saying, I don't believe, I'm not willing to accept that there's a higher authority above myself and my feelings. Because if there's a higher authority, chances are that higher authority is going to give me instructions of how I should live my life, and I don't want to live that way. So I'm going to reject the idea of God altogether. But in the end, the Bible clearly says there is no excuse. Everyone has been introduced to God, one way or another. We'll get back into this here in just a little bit, but isn't it beautiful to know that we can know God? Creation itself speaks to us about who God is. We'll get back there in a minute, but let's keep reading. Verse 21, because they knew God, they did not glorify Him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts became darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man, and birds, and four-footed animals, and creeping things. Now, that's kind of confusing. He's literally talking about idols here, isn't he? Are we all together today? He's talking about idols, isn't he? And he's talking about crafting idols after animals, but he tells us the problem with idolatry. Did you catch it? He says it right there in that phrase. It's very clear. We think the issue with idolatry is the idols. Can I get real with you for a minute? Every Christmas, well-meaning people, I'm not getting down on you, but well-meaning people come up to me and say, Pastor, we have an evergreen tree up at the front of the church. That's paganism. Well-meaning people. But listen to me. The issue with paganism was never the idols. Look carefully at what the Bible says there. Verse 23. They changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man. And he says, oh yeah, and they made idols that looked like animals and all sorts of other things. The issue with idolatry isn't being afraid of a statue or a tree. The issue with idolatry is that at the core of it, it's selfishness and self-worship. And if you have an issue with Christmas, don't have an issue with the trees. Have an issue with the fact that Christmas is often used to worship yourself rather than baby Jesus. And we spend time listening to sermons about all the paganism entering the church because there's this symbol and that symbol and this is going on and that's going on. And I'm shaking my head like, don't symbols change over time? People come up to me and say, what about this symbol? I said, did you know that pillars and steeples and stained glass windows and pews all came from the pagans too? No joke. And here we are trembling. Oh no. It was never the statues. It was never the idols. Here's the thing. God isn't in competition with gods that don't exist. The only one that's in competition for your heart is you. Only two people can sit on the throne of your heart, God or yourself. So, well-meaning folks at Christmas time, don't get offended by a tree. By the way, people say, oh yeah, well, it's in the Bible there somewhere. He is not talking about Christmas trees. It's not. If you hear preachers say that, say, okay, I'm turning this off because it's not the context. It's not true. That's not what I believe it's Ezekiel or Jeremiah are referring to. Why are you afraid of a tree? Really, think about that. thinking like a new creation. The issue, if you have an issue with Christmas, make it the materialization and the selfishness and all the stuff, I, because that is the true heart of paganism. Think about this. I go out into the forest, and I make an idol, and I take it to my house, and I figure out a way how to worship it and offer it sacrifices, and then what am I expecting in return? Blessings. I do something to get something, which is the heart of every false religion. Are you following me? That's the issue with idolatry. Idolatry is self-worship because it's saying, I can do something in order to get a blessing. That's not the message of the gospel, though, is it? The message of the gospel says, you can't do anything. It's unmerited favor. It's a free gift from God. Amen? Okay, I got sidetracked. It's all your fault. Verse 22, professing to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed animals and creeping things. Therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanliness and the lusts of their flesh to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the what? Creator who is blessed forever. For this reason, God, we're going to jump down to verse 28. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do things that are not fitting. You see how the downward spiral begins? Taking your eyes off from the one who can be known and spiraling downward all the way to a debased mind that you can't even see the light anymore. See the danger there? Let's break this down a little bit. Here's the first thing we know from what Paul just told us. The human mind can, in principle, grasp the truth about God. Isn't that beautiful to know? The God of the universe, the one who can measure the universe with the span of his hand, as Isaiah says. We're not even a speck on a speck on a speck on a speck in comparison to the entire universe, but yet we can know him by the things that he's made. He even says, even his eternal power and Godhead. We can know the deep things of God by looking at what he's created. You better spend time in God's creation. By the way, I'm also glad that he gave us his word. Do you know why? Because sometimes human beings look at his creation and we mix in our own ideas and our own thoughts and we get the wrong ideas. Amen? So we see the story, the gospel of creation, and then we go to the word of God to make sure that we're thinking along the right track. Amen? And it makes perfect sense. I want to test you now because we went over this a few months ago. What did God design Eden and the original creation as? Somebody got it in first service. A temple. What do you mean? The sanctuary, right? How do I know? What was the purpose of the sanctuary? Let them build me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. And what was the purpose of God building the sanctuary? Was to teach people about himself, amen, and to be with them. That's why God created Eden and creation in the first place. To teach mankind about himself and to be with them, amen? It's no wonder we can understand more about God from creation, because he built it as the first earthly sanctuary. Let's test you again. How many sanctuaries, earthly sanctuaries, are on earth? Ah, somebody's listening. How many are there? Seven, thank you. What was the first one? Okay, stop, hold on. What is the purpose of the sanctuary? That I may dwell among them and that I may know God better, right? Or we may know him better. What was the first one? Eden. What was the second one? Wilderness Tabernacle. What was the third one? Solomon's Temple. What was the fourth one? Herod's Temple. What was the fifth one? Jesus himself! Are you all with me? Was God dwelling with us in Jesus? Do we look to Jesus to know more about God? Absolutely. What's the sixth one? The church! God dwells in us by the Spirit, amen? And does the world know more about God by us? Amen. What's the seventh one? When the sixth one gets it right, the seventh one comes. And what is the seventh one? The New Jerusalem. You guys weren't all with me there. I think what I'll do is just recycle all my sermons. I'm kidding. The human mind can grasp the truth about God because that's the way He made creation. Amen? The mind, Paul told us this, the mind determines behavior. Amen? Now think about this. What did God originally place in us after the fall? A hatred of sin and the way this world works. Are we all together? So what then determines a lifestyle or choices? I just told you. I used the word. It's choice that sets us down another track. Jesus died to let us choose. Amen? He died to give us freedom. And so since enmity or hatred of sin and the way this world works is already within us, placed there by God, to go a different direction is a personal choice. That's important to know. To go a different direction than God's will, to associate ourselves with the way this world works and the death that's here, is a choice. And by the way, when you do that, just like Eve, you're taking your eyes off from, your focus off from, your heart off from your Creator, and where do you begin to place it? On yourself. And so your passions and your pride and your ideas and it becomes your God. So essentially what we're saying here is that you can have corrupted thinking. Does that sound like anybody we hear about in Scripture? Because of your beauty, your wisdom has become corrupted. Who is God talking about when He said that? Lucifer. Here's the point about Lucifer. Lucifer, once he fell, could not even see beauty in the character of God anymore. Do you know why? Because he began that downward spiral and eventually ended up in the place where he no longer thought that light was light. He thought darkness was light and light was darkness. That's what's happening all around us. It's what's happening in our world. But it begins with a choice. Let's go on. The mind is closely related to the heart. Actually, in many places in Scripture, they're interchangeable. The term is interchangeable. They're one and the same throughout the Bible, the mind and the heart. Let's actually read from verse 23 again. It says, "And change the glory of the incorruptible God into an image like that of corruptible man, and birds, and four-footed animals, and creeping things. Therefore God also gave them up to uncleanliness and lusts of their hearts, to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for a," what? "Lie, and worship the creature rather than the Creator." What begins in the mind filters to the heart. It becomes behavior. Here's the effects. Idolatry is closely related to the heart. My friends, we as a church and Christians in the day and age in which we're living should be a lot less concerned with ancient paganism and be far more concerned with new paganism. Do you know what new paganism is based on? Self. Do you know what old paganism was based on? Self. The issue with paganism has always been self-worship. Are we all together? You following me? That's been the issue. So we can get caught up in worrying about ancient paganism and not realize that by becoming obsessed with conspiracy theories and weird ideas, we're actually worshiping self because we get a thrill out of it. We get a thrill out of condemning people that don't see things the same way as us. This downward spiral makes our thinking become dehumanized and dehumanizing. We used the example last week of soulmates. Do you remember this? Which does not come from Scripture. The idea of the other half, your other half, doesn't come from Scripture. It's a Greek idea. And it's kind of come into our culture through the ages. Do you remember the myth? How many of you remember? See if I have to review it. Oh, not very many of you. Okay, here we go. The ancient Greeks believed that mankind was created with two heads, four arms, and four legs. Okay? They decided one day that they were going to climb up Mount Olympus and throw Zeus off his throne. So the way that Zeus chooses to punish man is he cuts them in half, ever leaving man to search the earth for their other half, or their soulmate. Adam was not sad in Eden before Eve was made. And this ties in with this thought perfectly. Think about this with me. If you believe that Eve was only created to please Adam, you've made Eve a prostitute. Eve was made to bear the image of God, and through that relationship, they got to know God better. But Jesus said, man shall leave his father and mother and cleave unto his wife, and the one half plus one half will equal one. Is that what he says? He says the two will become one. And through this idea that a person can please me, a person can be the source of my happiness, makes us worship our passions and our lusts, looking for a human being to somehow complete ourselves. But what we do is we dehumanize a person and make them an object. And then we get married based on these pretenses, and then when the object doesn't quite have its luster anymore, we somehow start looking for luster somewhere else. Use that word on purpose, by the way. The idea that you can use a human being for your own gain or your own benefit. You make him an idol. They become a source of worship, but it's happened all throughout our culture. You talk about slavery. Did you know in this world there are more slaves right now than there ever has been in the history of Earth? All over the world, children are being used in horrible ways. Women are being used in horrible ways. Men are being used in horrible ways. Why? Because our culture has been on that downward spiral. Humanists somehow would make us think that we're getting better and smarter. I don't think that's the case. It's actually not biblical. It's actually quite the other way. I like to think that we're holding with our intelligence, but I'm not quite so sure. The only reason maybe we need computers is because we need computers. They didn't invent them because they didn't need them back then. I don't know. Their minds just work better. How do they build the pyramids? How do they build these amazing ancient structures without the tools that we have? Because they were more primitive. That's what we're told. Could that possibly be? God allows the process, though, to take its natural course. Unfit decisions lead to an unfit mind. Which is why, my friends, it's so important that we learn to think like new creations, like born-again people, so we can guard our minds. And of course, this all goes through our relationship with Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit, but to guard our minds against unfit decisions so that we don't begin that downward spiral so that we think the light is darkness and the darkness is light. Are you following me? It eventually leads to the inability to grasp truth. Some might say, well, why doesn't God intervene? Well, one way he intervenes is through you and me to go to people when they're on this downward spiral. But another point is that if God somehow put an end to all of this mess right now, some might serve him out of fear. When the first domino fell and Pandora's box, so to speak, opened and this world began its downward spiral, God had to let it run its course. He couldn't put an end to it right then because he wants us to choose to love him, not to love him out of fear. In fact, he told us the parable about the sower. Do you remember the parable about the sower? And his disciples come up and say, well, who did this? Who sowed all these weeds? What did he say? An enemy did this. Jesus says, the reason that I don't come in and uproot them before it's time is because if I do that, some of the wheat might be uprooted along with the tares. So in other words, if God intervenes too much in this madness, some of us may lose our hope and our faith along with it. This thing is running its course to show us without a shadow of a doubt that God's way is the only way. But I don't want to get to the place where I can't see that anymore. That's why constantly we need to understand that God sent Jesus into the world to be the light amongst darkness. Amen? So that we can know God, we can see Him. There won't be any more questions. We can know what love is. We can know what humanity was made for. We can know how life was supposed to be when we look at Jesus to clear up all the questions. And Jesus' life was the life that God designed in the first place. When you look at Jesus, you see what a true human being was supposed to be. We are something else. What did your mama say? He's really something else. I don't know. And in a way, we are. We're something else. We're not what God designed. Jesus was. He still had the body of a man that had been subjected to thousands of years of decay. And until we get to heaven, we won't know fully what God made in the beginning. But the point of all of this is, when you look at Jesus, you see what a true human being was supposed to be. There's also good news, because Ephesians 5:8 says, "For we were once darkness, but now we are what? Light in the Lord. Walk as children of the what?" Did you know that you can be the light of Jesus in this sin-darkened world? Did you know that you can be the light piercing through the thinking, the degraded and debased thinking of this world? It can be us, amen? What a huge and amazing privilege this is. It's a responsibility. It's something so beautiful. God is asking us to look at the life of Jesus and begin to think about our world. How does a child of the kingdom live within this world? I can't answer that for you specifically. I mean, we could go through it. We could talk about the Christian life. But what I'm talking about is, how do you live as a new creation in your context where God has placed you? That's something that we all need to struggle with and wrestle with God. Our tendency is to run away from those challenging moments, from those difficult moments. But in many ways, if you don't stay there, and I'm not saying putting ourselves in vulnerable situations, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, though, is if you run away from those friends, who's going to reach them? When you become a Seventh-day Adventist, this used to be what people would tell you. You got to leave your church and you got to leave your friends. But if you leave, who's going to reach them? I'm not worried about you being influenced by things that aren't true. Once you know what's true, you're not going to be deceived again. What God has called us to do is to go into where He has placed us and be light. Not to be afraid of the world. Jesus is reigning on high. I'm not afraid of this world. He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's asked me to go into the darkness and be light. We can't live with a spirit of fear, but He says He's given us a mind to think. Can I challenge you a little more here today? Can I do that? We're starting to descend. We're going to land the plane here pretty soon. I want to challenge us, because in our approach as Christians, and sometimes even in our approach as the church, we have done this. We have at times made our traditions to be idols. Now, let's go back to where we started in the beginning. What is the heart of true idol worship? Self-worship. Remember that as I go to this next slide. Because this is the process that we usually make people go through before we can say that they're part of God's kingdom. So they start out as an individual wherever they are. We reach them, we reach out to them, we make them a Jesus follower, and we say, okay, you believe in Jesus, you accept these foundational truths, you think that's really important, but then when you're coming from the outside, you come from a different worldview, a different culture, a different view of thinking, people are made to think that I have to accept a culture before I can go into the kingdom of God. Let me ask you this question. And let me back up for a second. Here's the bottom line, then we're going to break off from this a little bit. There are non-negotiables, amen? Non-negotiables. Foundational scriptural truths that we don't stray from. Okay, so we've got that set. But let me start asking you some questions. Where does it say in the Bible that I have to wear a suit and tie to church? Now, I choose to wear a suit and tie. That's my choice. Y'all are going to come in, you know, like bib overalls and jeans next week. But my point is, in some cultures, people would look at a suit and tie and go, "What in the world are you wearing?" But at times, mission work has said, you got to put on a suit before you're a Christian. And you got to sing our songs. And until you sing our songs, you're not a Christian. And until you start living like we're living, and I'm not talking about the non-negotiables, I'm talking about other things. Until you start living like we're living and looking like we're looking and singing like we're singing, you're not part of the kingdom of God. Most of what we do in our traditions are just that, traditions. And here's the point. Most of us, not all of us in here, but many of us have come from a background that was influenced by Western Europeans. And so our version of church often is a Western European influence. If the British were the first missionaries to reach your people, probably your church and the way you do it looks that way, and the way you dress and the things that you do. But what about people all around the world that are coming to the Twin Cities, from Somalia and the middle and other places in the Middle East, the Far East? Would we ask them to be a Jesus follower and then enter our culture before they can enter the kingdom of God? Or can they be a king, can they be a Jesus follower in their context? Always remembering, and people are calling up the conference right now, "Oh, Pastor Hall is preaching crazy stuff." There are non-negotiables that are cross-cultural because they're very clear in Scripture. But anything that goes beyond those non-negotiables is culture and tradition. And we have made it this much harder at times because in this little bubble, it looks like one step. But when you ask someone to change the way they dress and change the way they think and change the way they see the world and change the way they sing and change the way they do this and change the way they do that, you're asking them to do all of these steps. So accepting a culture is far more than just one step. It's a whole bunch. And then once you look like us and sing like us and act like us and do what we do, then you can enter the kingdom of God. What if the graph looked like that? The individual becomes a follower of Jesus and they're taught the non-negotiables, true, yes, the very important things that are foundational to the gospel and Scripture. By the way, can anybody think of something that happened in Scripture that is exactly this discussion? When did this happen? You tell me. I'm going to let you ponder this for a minute. This very discussion happened in Scripture. Do we convert people to our culture first? Or do we bypass our culture and let them into the kingdom as true Christians and followers of Jesus? Think about it. When did it happen? I'll sit here till you figure it out. Paul and Peter. Yeah, you're on the right track. The Jerusalem Council. Isn't that the exact discussion that they had? You know, grown men are going to have to be circumcised? You know, but that's what they were saying. You got to look like us to enter the kingdom of God. Are you following what I'm saying here? This is so important for us to understand. What are the non-negotiables? And let me say this about Southview. Praise God, we've got a group of people that kind of understand this. That's why we're so multicultural here. We accept people from many cultures, many backgrounds, many languages. It's beautiful to see, but I want you to take this and really grasp this. You know, we all think that our culture is the holy culture. All of us do. The way we dress and the way we sing is more spiritual than someone else. But then what we end up doing is saying, you know, there's another step to get into the kingdom. It's not biblical. So we as new creation thinkers, born again thinkers, have to go out into this world and think this way. How can I go into my context and make a Jesus follower? My friends, we need mechanics for Jesus. And we need doctors for Jesus. And we need nurses for Jesus and teachers for Jesus. To not separate your teaching from your faith and say, okay, you know, when I'm at church, I'll be a Christian. When I'm in the classroom, I won't. We need people that will influence this world and the people around you for light, the light of Jesus. Where God has placed you, you have been called to be the light. And here's why. People that have gone down this downward spiral into darkness, so they think light is darkness and darkness is light, God has called you to think and act differently so that you can help them begin to open the door to think and act differently and meet King Jesus. And the reason that I'm bringing this out today is that don't make their faith walk harder on them than the Bible says it should be. And when you add all of that stuff that's maybe good, it's good to dress up for church, right? It's good to sing songs in church. But just because you do things differently doesn't mean it's wrong. And I'm going to say this also, it may get me in a little bit of trouble. No, it won't. It won't get me in trouble. But think about this. Most of the stuff in culture is neutral. For the most part, is neutral. Like idols. It's just a stone statue, right? What do I do with that idol? What heart and spirit do I put behind it? Makes a big difference. You know, missionaries over the years have gone to different tribes in Africa who don't wear as much clothing as we do. Different places throughout the world. And they say, okay, to be a Christian, you got to wear a suit. And these are people that don't wear many clothes. But unless you wear a suit, you can't be a Christian. And do you know what began to happen all over the world? Christianity became equated with dress and certain kinds of music and certain kinds of this and certain kinds of that. And do you know what it wasn't equated with throughout the world? Jesus Christ. There are many people throughout this world that to be a Christian means that you're a beer drinking, inappropriate stuff watching heathen. That's what they think about Christians. For some reason, the world has equated Christianity with something other than Jesus Christ. So I want to challenge you today. What are the non-negotiables in Scripture? And then how can you take your walk with Jesus into your context to the people that He's called you to be with to influence your world? Because if you don't, who's going to? Last couple of slides here, James, and then I'll let you sing. Ultimately, what we need is kingdom influences in every place. Amen? People that will live in the world to be an example of the kingdom of God, to break people out of corrupt thinking. And remember, as we've said time and time again here at Southview, the best way to speak cross-culturally to people that don't seem to understand, the only language that speaks to every person is trust and love. Acts of kindness, acts of trust, acts of love are what speaks to the heart of every man and woman. Don't preach to them first. Show them that they can trust you first. How can you live in your context but think like a believer? How can you live and think like a new creation in Jesus? Because we have been placed here in this city, in this context, to reach this city. Number one, thinking like a new creation, thinking like someone that's born again, does not take us down the path that Paul described to us. It keeps our eyes in worshiping the Creator Jesus, amen? But there are a lot of people that have gone down that road. And unless we go to them thinking and acting and living like a new creation, who's going to reach them? I struggled with the appeal the first service because there's so many things we could make an appeal on. But my true appeal to you today is, what does it mean to live in this world? What does it mean to live in this world and think like a new creation? To be a kingdom influence where God has placed you. The other appeal is, let's stop putting more expectations on people and requirements that are based on our culture and our tradition that aren't the non-negotiables. Let's not make it harder on them than it needs to be. By the way, Jesus' yoke is not heavy, it's light, amen? God has called us to this city in this place. What does it mean for you in your life to think like a new creation? Let's stand and sing our closing song. Through baseball, and my non-negotiable for baseball was I didn't play on Sabbath. Had I negotiated that, I would not have been able to be the witness that I was to so many people throughout the years. Some would say, don't play at all. To me, it was a witness and it was a ministry. It's beginning to happen again in the life of my son. He started to play. His non-negotiable is Sabbath. Interesting thing happened this week. Because we've been having him involved in baseball, I've met some fathers, and the fathers found out that I was a pastor first, and they found out that I had played a lot of years, and they said, would you please do a clinic for us, for our sons, to teach them how to pitch? I said, yes. We had our pitching clinic on Thursday night. We worked with the boys, and at the end I told them that the reason that they're playing is to become better men. That message resonated with one of the dads. He went over to one of the other dads and asked who I was. Told him I was a pastor. Came up to me at the end and he said, my name is so-and-so, and he says, I teach theology at Bethel University. I'd love to talk to you more about this someday. How can you think like a new creation in your context? Keep your non-negotiables because that's part of your witness, but how can you be used in your context? Use your gifts, your skills, your passions for God. Father, bless these people as we take this challenge with us out of this place. Father, please teach us how to be new creation thinkers. It's not just about living, it's also about thinking. And we need to think our way through the challenges of trying to witness to this world. But Lord, keep us strong. Help us to keep our eyes and our faith on Jesus. But Lord, teach us to think like new creations. Help us not to live with a spirit of fear. Help us to live with a sound mind, going out into our world and being the light that we've been called to be. We thank you for this wonderful privilege and this great challenge you've given to us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a great Sabbath. We hope you stay for lunch.